Hey there, welcome to West Valley Church Online. We are so glad you've chosen to worship with us today. One of the most difficult things we've faced as a church during these challenging times has been how to foster a sense of community while we're so far apart. And one of the big ways we've been able to do that is through small groups. If you are not already a part of a small group, we would encourage you to fill out a digital connection card online so that we can get you connected. Our small groups meet through video chat, through audio conference calls, through email, through group text messages, but they are staying connected, and that is so important during this time. Also, we want to give you the opportunity to connect with each other on Sundays during our online worship experiences. And so we've started streaming our services at 10 a.m. using our new Church Online platform so that you can chat with pastors, you can chat with greeters, you can chat with each other before and after services in our digital foyer. It's an exciting way to connect with each other and worship at the same time while we are so far apart. So what does this mean? What does this look like? If you have been watching our online services through your TV, then we encourage you to continue doing so. You can log on YouTube and it will start streaming at 10 o'clock. However, if you've been watching on your mobile device or computer, we encourage you, instead of going to YouTube, to go to wvc.online.church. There you can watch the video and chat during the service, before and after the service, request prayer requests, and much, much more. For those of you watching it on your TV, pull up that website, wvc.online.church, on your phone or tablet, and participate in the chat while you watch it on your TV. So while I have you here, I want to take you through our new online worship platform. One of the first things you'll notice when you log on to wvc.online.church is that there are three lines at the top left of your screen. When you tap on those, you'll see links for a connection card, for giving online, and for requesting prayer. The best way to experience community through wvc.online.church is by holding your phone upright. You'll see the video at the top, those three lines at the top left, and then you'll see a section for chatting. You can chat with others, talk to others, encourage Pastor Mike during his sermon, ask questions, and our hosts and pastors will be there to answer those questions. You'll also notice a button floating over the feed that says Request Prayer. At any time during the service, you can press that and our pastors and hosts will be glad to pray for you. Throughout the service, you may see different buttons that come up in the feed. Those are great ways for you to engage with us, to pray with us, links to give, links to show that you've become a follower of Christ. And we encourage you to participate in worship with us. Thank you for watching this short tutorial, and now you can get things set up and be ready to worship with us online today. Thank you.
happy 4th of July weekend. It's kind of a strange time. There's not a lot of big events going on, but hopefully you can find some time that you're able to spend this weekend with your family and make some good family memories. We sure have lots of those.
We do. I was just kind of thinking about a story. The boys were quite young, and one of them, we were at a big display, a big firework display, and they did not like the loud smokes.
That's right. Kept saying, "I do not like these loud smokes." I won't say which son that was of the three, but I can assure you that they've all three outgrown any fears they might have of mm-hmm. loud smokes. These really are strange times. It's a different way to celebrate this holiday weekend. And yet, this is still the greatest country on the planet, for sure. I'm so grateful that we have all the freedoms that we do, and despite all of the things that we're going through, we still have the freedom to worship Christ, to talk about Jesus, and to share Him with other people, to pray together openly. And we sure want to do that for you. If you're not familiar with West Valley Church, we are a praying church. We love to pray for each other week in and week out. And we do that because we know that we're talking to a God who loves us as if we're the only ones in all the world to love. He loves you. And He loves you so much that He sent His one and only Son to die on a cross for you, so that you could be in relationship with God as your Father, and not in any other way, not judged, not distant, not anything, but loving Father over your life. And He would have sent His Son to die for you if you were the only one on the whole planet to die for. That's how much He loves you. And that's our confidence in prayer. That's why we love to pray for each other. And we'd be honored if we could pray for you this week, but you're going to need to let us know how we can do that.
And in order for us to pray, we just want to let you know there are a lot of ways in which you can contact us. So please feel free to email us and request prayer from that, or call the church office. Or if you're worshiping with us online on Sundays, you can click the prayer tab and do it that way. Of course, our social media pieces also have a form you can fill out.
Yeah.
Please let us know.
Yeah, you can reach out to us in any of those ways, but I promise you, we have a team of people who pray every week, including the pastors and the board members who pray every single week for our church family, and we'd be honored to include you in that time throughout the week. And I want to remind you too, as we prepare to worship together today, at the end of our time of worship, we're going to share in virtual communion. I'll lead us in a time of communion together. So if you haven't gotten your things ready, be sure to grab something like bread and something like grape juice so that you can share in that very important moment with us. And we wouldn't want you to miss it. And I hope you didn't miss our time of drive-up communion this last week. We had a really great time together at our drive-up communion service at our church.
We did. It was so wonderful. I think I had the best job because I got to greet everyone as they were coming through. But just to see you and to speak with you and to pray with you, and then of course to watch you go through, and each of our pastors had a station for communion. Wow, it makes me tear up. It was really beautiful.
It was very meaningful for us to be able to be with you and to mm-hmm. see you again and to pray for you as we ministered the sacraments to you like that. It was really, really a powerful time. We look forward to being able to do it again very soon. But in case you missed it, we have a great little slideshow that we want to show you of some of the pictures from that time together this last week. Just before, we'll take a moment to text and greet each other. Watch these pictures and then be prepared to text and greet someone in your church family.
Thank you. Good morning. It's great to be worshiping together again today. We have the unique opportunity right here and right now to raise our hearts and voices at the same time and in the same spirit as we sing our love songs to the Lord. Think of it. Even though we can't hear all our voices raised together in unison, God can. Distance is not a barrier for Him, and He hears us as one undivided people worshiping together. Listen to these words from Psalm 145 that express our heart's cry to honor our good God today. You are wonderful, Lord, and you deserve all of our praise because you are much greater than anyone can understand. You're merciful, Lord. You are kind and patient and always loving. You are good to everyone, and you take care of all your creation. All creation will thank you, and your loyal people will praise you.
As we come into your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely. Because of your love.
though we're apart, it does not mean that we're not connected. We are still united by God and in prayer. Allow me to pray for us this morning. God, thank you so much for sending your Son, Lord, that we may have a relationship with you. And it is in that relationship that we have. It is in Jesus Christ that we have hope. Lord, during this uncertain time in a world, we seek you. Lord, please continue to guide us and direct us, Lord, back to you. Help us to seek out ways to be connected to you, Lord, so that we may bring your peace here. May you continue to work through us and in us to bring peace to our world. Lord, we know that you are the author of all healing. And for those that have sent in prayer requests for healing to the church office or even here now, Lord, may you bring your healing hand upon them. Lord, may you bring comfort to those grieving. May you bring peace and calm to those who are anxious. Lord, may you start the change of the world with us. Lord, make us an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. And all of this, Lord, start with us. Move in us that we may move in your community. Amen. Amen. We're going to continue together in worship by receiving tithes and offerings. You can send your tithe or offering through the church website or the church app, or feel free to mail it to the church office. Let's worship together.
I see the Lord. See the Lord.
assure you that I always pray about what I'm going to preach on, including when we're going through a sermon series like we are with this one called On This Rock. We've been studying the letters of Peter that are found in the New Testament. And even though the scripture passages are already laid out for us, there's always a fresh word that's laid alongside those important instructions and reminders that maybe we've heard before. I want to make sure that what I say is always aligned with the Holy Spirit and with the Word of God. But that doesn't mean that I don't wrestle with God over what I'm going to preach about. Part of me this week wanted to talk about how we're doing with this pandemic, because I know that we are all getting weary of it. Some of us are discouraged and depressed and lonely. Some of us are grieving the loss of a loved one because of the virus, and others of us haven't been able to visit loved ones in the hospital because of the virus. Some of us have been out of work. I know that all of us want to get back to church together, and we're praying and confident that's going to happen very soon. But some of us think that we're victims of political overreach. Others of us think that our community isn't doing enough to protect us from the virus. All of those opinions have been shared with me by people who are also telling me when they think we should be opening the church again. And then on top of all that, there's the angst and the upheaval that we constantly hear on the news and on social media. We realize that there are major changes going on in our culture. Many of them are for the better. Some of them are being propagandized. And it's unnerving and it's frustrating, and sometimes it can make us maybe a little fearful or angry or even helpless. But I want you to know that your leadership team, West Valley Church, the church board that you elected, and your pastoral team, we're watching these situations very closely, and we have had many, many, many conversations about what's going on and about when we're going to open up again. For sure, though, we will err on the side of caution for the sake of those who are most vulnerable among us. Your leaders are setting their own feelings and their own individual rights aside, and they're doing what the Bible tells us to do, which is to look out for the most vulnerable. And I know this time is frustrating. I understand all of that. Believe me, I have experienced all of those feelings and all of those thoughts, and maybe even more. And it makes my prayers for you that much heavier, because I feel the weight of that on our collective church family. And so while it's heavy on my heart and in my prayers, I wanted to preach about it, and so I prayed about that. And the Lord has been clear that He wants us to turn to His Word. It's been amazing to me how at times these passages from 1st and 2nd Peter have spoken directly to our situations. And other times, it's become more of a way to put that stuff aside and focus on God. But either way, how can we ever go wrong? Whatever our circumstances might be, how can we ever go wrong by leaning into God's Word and by learning to be closer to Christ and by allowing the Spirit to transform us more and more into Christ's likeness and His nature? How can we ever go wrong? So I pray that's what's going to happen for us with this time. Last week we looked at 2 Peter 2, and we saw the warning signs to look for and the behaviors of false teachers and preachers. And that was really helpful to keep us spiritually on track, to keep us from getting off track. Today we're going to look at chapter 2 again, and this time I believe it's going to challenge our own walk with Christ and sound some very clear warnings for us. Because even though this chapter is primarily about false teachers, we can learn from their negative example just as much as we can learn from the positive examples that we find in the Bible. So let me read the first 12 verses, and then let's learn from them. This is 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. But there were also false prophets among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies, even denying the sovereign Lord who bought them, bringing swift destruction on them. Many will follow their depraved conduct and will bring the way of truth into disrepute. In their greed, these teachers will exploit you and fabricate stories. Their condemnation has long been hanging over them, and their destruction has not been sleeping. For if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell, putting them in chains of darkness to be held for judgment, if he did not spare the ancient world when he brought the flood on its ungodly people, but protected Noah, a preacher of righteousness, and seven others, if he condemned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah by burning them to ashes and made them an example of what's going to happen to the ungodly, and if he rescued Lot, a righteous man, who was distressed by the depraved conduct of the lawless, for that righteous man, living among them day after day, was tormented in his righteous soul by the lawless deeds he saw and heard. If this is so, then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from trials and to hold the unrighteous for punishment on the day of judgment. This is especially true of those who follow the corrupt desire of the flesh and despise authority. Bold and arrogant, they're not afraid to heap abuse on celestial beings. Yet even angels, although they are stronger and more powerful, do not heap abuse on such beings when bringing judgment on them from the Lord. But these people blaspheme in matters they do not understand. They're like unreasoning animals, creatures of instinct, born only to be caught and destroyed, and like animals, they too will perish. Well, last week we identified these bad guys and what they do. Now we want to learn from their example, starting with number one, don't believe them. Don't believe them. It's in verses 1 to 3. Peter gives us plenty of warnings here not to believe what these bad guys are teaching. False teachers and preachers, they're sneaky. They'll very subtly and secretly introduce destructive heresies, Peter says. A heresy, it might help you to know what that word means because we don't use it a lot. A heresy is any teaching or doctrine that is outside of or counter to established biblical truth. So they'll start with something innocuous, something small, but before you know it, they will have worked their way in to cause you to even question whether or not Jesus is God, God's one and only. It's bad enough that they teach these false truths, but they do it to manipulate you. They do it out of selfish motives and self-satisfaction. Sometimes they'll do it just for sheer power and control, but they'll usually do it to get your money from you, to make themselves rich. Now, we talked about that last week, so I'm not going to repeat myself. But you've got to know the truths from the Bible and what the Bible teaches so that you don't fall into that trap. That's why we provide you with a sermon manuscript and why we put the scripture references in the notes for you. So you can look up those verses and make sure I'm telling you the truth according to the Bible. Don't take my word for it. Go to the word for it. Don't take my word for it. Go to the word for it. Be like the Bereans in the book of Acts. This is what it says about them. But the people of Berea were more open-minded than those in Thessalonica and gladly listened to the message. They searched the scriptures day by day to check up on Paul and Silas's statements to see if they were really so. Go to the word so you won't be misled. The problem is that these false teachers are often very charismatic personalities, so you find yourself wanting to believe what they're saying, which makes it all the more important to know the difference, to know the truth for yourself. It's important not to believe them, because if you do, then that is soon going to impact your attitudes and your behaviors. If you have played any sports, you'll understand this example I want to give you. Because you realize before long that it's not just a physical activity or a physical game. There is a mental side of that sport or the game as well. If an athlete is going to do his or her best, then he or she cannot get into their own head, for one thing, and neither can they let their opponent get into their head. Because once you've listened to any voice, whether it's yours or someone else's, or your opponents, when you listen to any voice that causes you to question your skill or your ability or your training or distract your focus, then your ability to execute will reflect that line of thinking instead. And that's why Peter next warns us, second, to don't act like them. Don't act like them. That's in verses 10 to 12. If we start to believe what they're saying, then before long, we will find ourselves beginning to act on those beliefs. The Bible warns us about this in Proverbs 23:7. It says, "For as he thinks in his heart, so is he." In other words, what we think is what we become. And so if we believe those false teachers, it won't take long before we'll start acting like they do. Now, I don't think we need to spend too much time on this, because really all you need to do is review what we talked about last week to realize that their behavior is not something that we want to copy. Peter uses these words to describe their behavior: depraved, greedy, exploitative, shameless, arrogant, unreasoning, instinctual, carousing, reveling in sin, adulterers, seducers, empty, boastful, lustful, slaves of depravity, animals like dogs and pigs. And that's only in that passage we just read today. So we hear that and we think, well, I would never act that way. But if you are not on your guard, you got to be careful, because you might begin acting in those ways before long, little by little. Remember what the Apostle Paul said about false teachers in Galatians 5:9. He said, "This false teaching is like a little yeast that spreads throughout the whole batch of dough." That's why Peter has been warning us over and over again to be vigilant, to be sober-minded, to be on our guard, to be alert. So don't believe them. Don't act like them. And then third, heed the warnings and assurances. Heed the warnings and assurances that we find in verses 4 to 10. Peter warns us by sharing a reminder of God's history in dealing with sin, and then gives assurances to us if we continue to live for Christ and not for ourselves. So I want to show you those three warnings that he gives us, or those negative examples, and then two assurances or positive examples that he gives us. I want to show them to you quickly, and then I'll explain them. Essentially, Peter says, if God didn't spare angels — that's a negative example in verse 4. If God didn't spare angels, and God didn't spare the ancient world — that's a negative example in verse 5. But God protected Noah, and God condemned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. So Noah's a positive example from verse 5, and then Sodom and Gomorrah, the third negative example from verse 6. But God rescued Lot — that's a positive example from verses 7 and 8. If those things are true, then God knows how to rescue godly people. That's the positive conclusion that's in verse 9. And God knows how to hold the unrighteous for judgment. That's the negative example in verses 9 and 10. So quickly, let me explain, and then we'll be on our way to a better walk with Christ. When Peter talks, first of all, in that passage, as you listen to that, when Peter talks about God not sparing angels, that's kind of difficult for us to understand. The original readers probably understood that, but us, not so much. Part of the problem is that Peter is not referencing our Old Testament. He's referencing some other very well-known Jewish spiritual writings. In the Bible, we have some indirect references to the sin of angels, but nothing to the extent of what Peter is referring to. Peter is likely getting this information from the books of Enoch, the Book of Wisdom, and Ecclesiasticus. Those are well-known ancient Hebrew spiritual books that have several stories in them that we don't find in our Bibles. And I don't want to spend a lot of time, honestly, going down this rabbit hole. So let me just say this. If angels, who are far more powerful than us and are always in God's presence, if those angels sinned, if they won't get away with it, and God sent them into the pit and locked them up until judgment day, then we can be sure that God will do the same with false teachers and to any of us if we sin. That's why we need Christ and what he's done for us. And we can talk about those angel stories at a different time. Next, if God didn't spare the ancient world, so God didn't spare angels, that's, remember that negative example. Second negative example, if God didn't spare the ancient world, but instead sent the flood. And third, if God didn't spare sinful cities and societies like Sodom and Gomorrah who faced destruction, three negative examples, then the false teachers and anyone else who sins is not going to get away with it either. On the positive side, if God spared a man like Noah and his family, and God spared a righteous man like Lot, then certainly God can rescue and protect and take care of those who put their faith in Christ when we remain faithful, even and especially in a pandemic. Now, one last thing before we share communion together, and then we'll close. If you read the stories in the Old Testament about Noah and about Lot, those guys were not exactly paragons of virtue or sterling examples of sanctification. The book of Genesis shares a shameful story of a drunken Noah after the flood. Genesis amply documents the shortcomings of Lot. So are these guys really good examples for us? And why did God spare them? Why is Peter using them as examples? And why did God spare them? Well, because God is merciful. And despite their failures, those men, those people never lost sight of the Lord. Peter selected these guys because the original readers and us, we can identify with them. Every Christian knows that we're saved by grace, not by our good works. But even after we are saved, and even after the Spirit fills us, we're still prone to struggle, and we're aware of how short we fall sometimes, like Noah and Lot. But because of Christ's death and resurrection, we can keep doing better and growing more and more like Christ, not excusing sin, but confessing it and repenting of it and being forgiven and stopping sinning. So let's never lose sight of Jesus. Let's keep living for him. And let's not let an ounce of false teaching into our lives. God can deliver and sustain you even in this difficult time. Keep your eyes on Jesus and stay committed to following him, and he will deliver and sustain you. Now let's prepare ourselves for a time of communion together. And I'll say what I always say when we do this together in worship, when we're in the same place. You do not have to be a member of the Church of the Nazarene to share together with us in communion. It does help if you're a believer in Jesus, because if you're not, this is really not going to be a whole lot more than just some kind of dry bread and some grape juice. It probably won't mean a whole lot. But even then, if you come to this time being open to God and genuinely seeking him, you may have an encounter experience with Christ that you have not had before. But all of us, we come before him with our hearts open and recognizing our need for his love. We acknowledge our need for and our dependence on Christ. And may this time affirm and strengthen our faith in Jesus. Let's pray together first. God, we bow before you, recognizing that what we're about to do is a sacred moment, a sacred act. It's a holy thing that we're doing. And it's made powerful and effective in spiritual ways that maybe we can't always comprehend. But Jesus, you established this for us. You said that we should do this. And so this is a sacred moment. And so we humble ourselves before you, God. We take a moment to make sure that our hearts are right before you and to confess any known sin failure in our walk with you, because we want to be right as we come before you in this time. And now, God, would you do what only you can do? Would you so fill this time and these moments and these elements to make them for us to be the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, that we might experience in a supernatural way and affirm and solidify in a supernatural way our relationship with you and our dependence on you because of what Jesus has done for us, in whose name we pray. Amen. We'll take your elements, and we start with the bread. The Bible tells us that during supper, Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks for it, knowing exactly what it was going to mean. And he broke it, passed it to his disciples, and he said, "Take this and eat this. This is my body broken for you. And as often as you do this, remember me." Go ahead now and take the bread. Then the Bible says, likewise, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This is the blood of a new covenant poured out for you and for many." And he was thinking of us today. "Poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." He said, "Take it and drink it. And as often as you do this, remember me." Now that you've taken the bread and the cup, let's pray. Father, again, we acknowledge our need for and dependence on Christ. If he had not given his body to be broken for us, shed his blood for us, we would still be lost. We would be a part of those examples that Peter gave us in the passage we looked at today. We'd still be condemned, held for judgment and punishment. But we thank you because of your grace and your mercy. That is not the case for us. We have trusted in Jesus and what he's done for us. Our lives have been transformed. We've been made alive. We've been made new, and we have a completely different future. One of purpose and peace and joy in this life, bringing the kingdom of God to this world and an eternity forever, forever with you. Thank you, God, for all that you've done for us out of your sheer grace and love. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let me close with Peter's closing comments. They're actually at the end of chapter 3 that we're going to be looking at in a couple of weeks, but I think they apply. This is what he says. "Therefore, dear friends, since you've been forewarned, be on your guard so that you may not be carried away by the error of the lawless and fall from your secure position, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and forevermore. Amen."
Because of your love.
Because of your love.